And Dr. Milind Nawalakhe to deliver his talk.
थोड़ा एडजस्ट करो। गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन। आई थिंक लॉट ऑफ थिंग्स विच आई वॉज सपोज टू यू नो टेल यू आर ऑलरेडी सीन अ लॉट ऑफ देम ड्यूरिंग सर्जरी। दिस इज बेसिकली अ सर्जरी ऑफ lot of unpredictability, and that is what it takes a very long learning curve as compared to any other surgery which I know of, at least in ENT. Silent endoscopy would take you anywhere from 2 to 5 years at least to, you know, begin with. Looking at number of cases which are less and the amount of equipments you require. I really appreciate what support I got today in Cooper, but what you realize today that like the stone case, if I have a holmium laser, I would just break it and go ahead. So when you are doing it in a setup where the things are less, then maybe you can be in trouble. So if you are doing in a private setup, which I prefer to do, where you know everything is there, but obviously you cannot have, like where I do at Nair, we don't have holmium, so there also I land up in such situations. So silent endoscopy, I think a lot of introduction part Sameer has done nicely. I dedicate all my work to my teacher, Dr. Kirtane, with whom I worked for a long time, all of you know. And with his inspiration, I went for training almost 10 years back, and now last 10 years I have been doing silent endo. This picture I always like to show that, you know, no stone in this picture you would find exactly same size and shape, and similar the situations you would face, you would not know what is happening the next moment, and you land up in such situations very often in silent endo. Almost every case, every situation is different. So Dr. P.P. Singh was the one with whom I started my training, and I've been to most of the people who are leaders in the silent endoscopy, Professor Hero, Professor Marshall, and Professor Zink. So to begin with, silent endoscopy began almost about more than 20 years back, where they started using cystoscope for removing the stones from the salivary gland. And if you see parallels in the treatment of ureteric calculi, right now we are almost everything what they do in urology, including a holmium laser. The formation of stone, there's no definite theory for formation of stone, and the commonest theory is there could be some food particle going in and then having accumulated some calcium deposits around it. The food particles, sometimes we find as a foreign body even in the duct when we go for a diagnostic silent endo or silent endo for just a chronic silent endoscopy. Sameer spoke about what to do in a distal stone and what to do about a proximal stone and a glandular stone. If you look at the chemical composition as per this report, most of it is phosphate salt stones and a very little oxalate and urate in that. The syolith analysis as such, I have not done my own study, but most of the stones are similar consistency, which has more calciums. Radiological investigations, as you know, we prefer a sonography sonography over any other modality. The CT scan come next, and then the MR xylography. Now, the xylography, the conventional xylography, even though it shows a very nice picture as you see here. Do you have a pointer here? Pointer there? As you can see here, I'll try and show you on this only. You can see a stone here which is giving little indentation. But, you know, nowadays we avoid doing conventional xylography for reasons like when the radiologists try to cannulate the duct, which is narrow, they would rather cause more damage than good. So, and since you have MR xylography, which is as good as xylography, even though expensive, but much a safer procedure, where saliva itself acts as a contrast, and you can see all the strictures or the stones. Even though for the stone, I would rather prefer a CT scan. Now, similar case we did today. Now, previously, if we had patients like this, we always used to have external incision and maybe a marginal mandibular. Coming to the dimensions, I don't know. I was not there in the initial part of the Sami's lecture. But if it is covered, basically we are looking at a caliber of 1 to 3 millimeter diameter if you talk of Stenson's or Wharton's duct. So it's quite a small diameter. And when it comes to pediatric, then it's still smaller. And what makes it difficult is you do not have any landmark other than the papilla and the hilum. In between, you have nothing. So you would not know exactly how much inside you are. It's all on the distances. Again, the distances are quite variable. The duct length is not fixed. It can be 5 to 7 centimeter. As I told you, I prefer a sonography. There are many reasons that why we prefer a sonography over any other. Firstly, sonography is a dynamic study where you can actually see the flow of saliva. When I do a sonography, I tell my sonologist to do it first without, first just a plain sonography, and then let patient chew some amount of vitamin C, maybe a lime or a vitamin C tablet. When the salivation is really more, and then you do another sonography, and you will distinctly see a difference that if there is an obstruction, if there is a stone, it is seen much better in the second sonography, which is done in maybe another half an hour or so. Reason for preferring sonography again is as obviously safer than CT and MRI, cost effective. Intraoperatively, a lot of time I'll end up in a situation, I'm doing a sialendo, I go in, I know that there is a stone and I just cannot locate it. It happens more in the beginning of your career when you are just starting a sialendo, and maybe stones which are much closer to hilum. In those cases, there are times that I had called my radiologists. I had to literally request them because you require a lot of time. And he would come. He would do a sonography where my scope or a guide wire is inside. And you can see the relative position of your stone to your guide wire or a stone, guide wire or a scope. And that helps you knowing whether you are continuing with the surgery or abandoning. If I see a stone which is more than 2 centimeters from where I can go maximum, then obviously I'm not going to struggle anymore and I would just call it off. As far as the CT scan is concerned, we just require a plain CT scan, especially in cases of sialithiasis. It would show you better dimensions and orientation and the shape of the stone. And MRI in cases where you don't see a stone and just suspect a stenosis of the duct. The disadvantage, it is obviously operator dependent, so your radiologist has to be very well versed with head and neck sonography. In fact, some centers like in Germany, they have a posting for ENT surgeon for 6 months in radiology. So like a cardiologist and gynecologist, even the ENT surgeon, they would do their own sonography for head and neck. Obviously, here we don't have that in India. So, as somebody rightly said, you require, I think Kaushal said, you require a lot of patience and you require patience to get trained in sial endoscopy. Now, difficulties. The main difficulty is, operating in a small duct where you have hardly any space around, and you are operating underwater, and it's not all other endoscopy. If you realize in ENT are air as a medium, and here you have water as a medium, that hampers your vision. Secondly, the fibers are very less, so picture quality cannot be as good as an endoscopic sinus surgery or a micro ear surgery. So that again is a limitation. Even if you have a best of the light source, you can't use it at a higher intensity because it would obviously become absolutely white. When you see absolutely white, as I told you during surgery also, either you are against the wall or your light is too bright or you have lost the lumen. I would still show you this video. I think you saw this during surgery also, that whenever my assistant just stops irrigating, I don't see anything. The moment it starts irrigating, you can see the lumen getting dilated. And without irrigation, you have to literally stop the surgery. As you see here, there's a stone. Finding the duct opening. Now it is more difficult in the submandibular than parotid. Now most of the ways of finding I already showed you. One is microscope. You have an option of using loop. Both have advantages, disadvantages. Microscope has a disadvantage that every time you have to get it in. As you realize in the last case, I was every time getting it in and getting out. If you have a loop, you can just shift onto the loop and the endoscope quite easily. But the demonstration-wise, microscope becomes easier. When you want to change the direction, the loop is better and the microscope is more difficult. But I personally prefer more of microscope rather than the loop, because loop has a fixed magnification and here you can change the magnification. The limitations, obviously there are limitations for every procedure. If it's a very, very large stone, like the last case, the stone is like borderline, 6 millimeter is little bigger and it was quite long and hard. Now the consistency of the stone is one thing which, in fact, if I have a patient even with a 3 millimeter stone, I would never tell him 100% I'll remove it. That's not possible in silent endoscopy, because the stone consistency you would not know. Consistency, if it is very hard, even a small stone impacted and a hard, then it would give a very difficult time removing it. If it is fragile, then I have removed even a stone which was 3 centimeter reported, but fragile into pieces, and I could take it out. If there are multiple strictures, as you saw in the first case, you may not be able to tackle all together. You may have to leave it for the later. Like that case, I would prefer to have a holmium laser and go through that thin membrane and then go on to the further part of the duct. If there is generalized narrowing of the complete duct, I just had one case like this where I put in a scope, a thinness of the scope, and throughout the duct was absolutely narrow. In those cases, silent endoscopy is not going to help you in any way. Recurrent strictures, you still have an option of operating repeatedly, but after 2 or 3 surgeries, especially in submandibular, patient would not be willing. Stones in the gland parenchyma, as you see here, very large stones, obviously this is going to go for an external surgery and not endoscopic. I don't think I would spend time on this. I think Samir just covered this. I was there. Complete exploration of the duct. Complete visualization of the ductal system comes at a little later stage. For today's workshop, I tried for last 15-20 days if I have a JRP case, but I didn't have one. Juvenile recurrent parotiditis, where you can really go in, you will not have much of a problem, and you can really go in till secondary and tertiary branches of salivary ductal system. About the instrument, Samit, did you cover this? I don't know. On the trolley. Yeah. So I think we showed you all these scopes there. This particular is a Langhans system where you have all-in-one scopes. All-in-ones means you have a forceps coming from the scope, you have a channel for irrigation, instrumentation, and visualization. Everything is together. So you don't have a sheath as I was using. This is the all-in-one scope, how it looks like. The advantage, only advantage which I see is most of the all-in-one scope of Erlangen, they have 1 centimeter marking. So that problem of how much depth you are in is not there. So you can really see and explore the duct inside. Burr, I think you saw the use of this. Now, the burr come in two sizes, 0.4 and 0.6 and 0.8. And depending on the situation, 0.6 is really very thin and difficult to use. 0.8 is the one which I was using today. This you saw, but this is one of the perfect way of going today. I couldn't go through that way because the situation. Now, if you notice, this stone is impacted. To drill onto an impacted stone or to use a laser, even on an impacted stone, is much easier. Laser, at least I can use on a mobile stone. It might just move a little bit. But burr, you can't because you don't have a strength for the stone to remain there. That is also what's happening today. Yeah. You have 265, 365 and 450. NM is their gauge. So usually the thinnest one, 265, is good enough. Now in laser, the problem is, you know, they have a guiding light. The guiding light is red and it goes from 1 to 10. Even if you get it at 1, it is so bright that inside everything is red. So you have to literally put off the light and once put on and then put off and then use the laser. You can't use laser while the guiding light is on. The forceps, as you saw today, they are reusable, they are autoclavable. You have grip like this or you have a grip like Blakesy. The baskets, again, you saw the use today. This is 4-wire which I was using. And you get, I think there was a question about baskets. So you get 3-wire, 4-wire and 6-wire. They are 0.4 and 0.6 millimeter in diameter. And the newer basket is a tipless basket. One of the basket which I was using was a tipless basket. This is how the basket grabbed the stone. Coming to stent. Now, I think when I was putting the Indian stent, I told you the imported stent are different. This is how they are different. I don't know. If you can see, there are flanges on the wall here. Once I insert the stent and fix it, the flanges will hold on to the wall and they will prevent spontaneous expulsion of the stent. Stent is kept there for about 4 weeks and on stent removal it almost takes the shape of the duct if you have inserted it in the complete length. I think this has come out of the context, but I wanted this slide to be last anyway. So, whoever wants to start the silent endoscopy, these are the concerns which, you know, most of the beginners comes with. The main difficulty is the training. At the end of my talk, I would have a brief 2 slides about how you can go about training. And equipment procuring now, I think the Carstos has their own set of basic and advanced, so there's not much of a problem. Good afternoon, everyone. I think a lot of things which I was supposed to, you know, tell you, you have already seen a lot of them during surgery. You should avoid glycopyrrolate and atropine. That would decrease the secretion, especially if you are doing under local anesthesia. Now, a lot of procedures under this can be done under local anesthesia. especially just the diagnostics can be done under local anesthesia. Now here in local anesthesia, what are the problems? The problem, rather than the pain, it's the water which is coming or the saline which is coming in the oral cavity. You need to put a suction continuously because your scope inside, he can't swallow. So you and the position cannot be lying down. It's a little semi supine position. You will have to do the scopy. In fact, one of especially just the diagnostics can be done under local anesthesia. Now here in local anesthesia, what are the problems? The problem, rather than the pain, it's the water which is coming or the saline which is coming in the oral cavity. You need to put a suction continuously because your scope inside, he can't swallow. So you and the position cannot be lying down. It's a little semi supine position. You will have to do the scopy. In fact, one of the centers where I was there, Erlangen, they prefer to do most of the cases under local, and they do it in a dental chair. So patient is sitting with a kidney tray in hand, and they do the procedure under local. In all these cases, post-operatively, we advise them massage over the gland. IV antibiotic just for a day and then oral antibiotics. Check scopy, as you saw in the cases today, obviously they would require another scopy after about 4 to 6 weeks. This type of swelling is unusual. Now, there are reasons. This was one of my initial cases. If you try to put a lot of irrigation in hope to see more, then you can land up with this. So I always tell my assistant to go very slowly and not forcefully, especially notice that when I am not watching anything, to stop the irrigation. Now when you start irrigating, a lot of fluid comes from the space around your scope or the sheath. When you are using a sheath into the therapeutic sheath, you have a channel for the instruments. The saline comes out from the channel from the instrument. There's a little leak from there, so the irrigation becomes easier. And in those cases, at that time, actually, there's very little collection which remains inside. But this swelling does not remain for very long. As you see here, in 24 hours, it just disappeared. Post-operatively, you will see some edema in the operated area. So what are the complications? Now, I think Samir, most of them he mentioned. Now, there are not major complications to sial endo. That is one thing which should not hold you back from going in for sial endo. Maximum what you may not find the opening and you may not be able to introduce, you may not be able to take out the stone. But all this, you obviously, I am telling you that you need to include into your consent. I have a standard consent form which any of you want, you can just write to me. I'll send. Right now I don't have with me, but I'll email it to you and you can use the same. Where it is mentioned, right from not able to pass the scope to I may have to remove the gland on table as an emergency, as Samir mentioned in one of the complication, that when there is complete extirpation of the duct, which is the worst complication we can have. Why extirpation happens is when you have a stone which is totally impacted and you feel that you have grabbed it quite nicely, especially in forceps. Then in that case, it might just pull out the whole duct. I had only once landed up in a situation where I was holding the stone and the basket just broke. But luckily, when I cut the basket, it just got released. But if it doesn't get released, you may have to open and remove the basket and the stone completely. This is one of the cases of if any of you have listened to my previous lectures, then you must have heard about this. But this was a unique one which I wanted to put. This 50-year-old man with recurrent parotiditis, and this was one case which even in my initial period I did under local. Patient was advised superficial parotidectomy, and when my radiologist did a sonography, he told me there is a 3-centimeter stone. I told patient, okay, we'll start under local. If I can do anything, then I'll कि वो जनरल एनेस्थीसिया एंड कंटिन्यू. दैट इज वन वे दैट यू कैन स्टार्ट विथ. इन द बिगिनिंग योर प्रॉब्लम इज यू नो यू डोंट वॉन्ट टू टेल अ पेशेंट आउट कमिंग आउट ऑफ जनरल एनेस्थीसिया एंड टेलिंग हिम ओके आई कुडंट डू एनीथिंग. So that's the worst thing. You then what I used to do initially is give patient 4% xylocaine as a oral this thing, put some spray, maybe inject little around and find the duct. You can do that. Put in a guide wire, dilatation, all this you can do under local. You finish this and with my guide wire in position, my anesthetist would intubate. I just fix it there and intubate. Then you proceed, which is a painful part for the patient. So. In fact, that saves patient from general anesthesia. Now, this patient similarly, I started with local, but I was surprised that I never had to give him GA in spite of being a case where I'll just see this video should run. Yeah. So as you saw in the history, he had recurrent right parotid swelling. And when I went in, which was reported as 3 centimeter stone, was actually a bunch of very small stones, which I could take out very easily, and they were fragile. Now today stones, which in the my last case was very very hard. If the stone is like this, then it would just break off. You apply a burr, you apply a basket, it would break off into pieces and will come out. Sorry, I think it went back to. This is basically use of baskets and burr, most of it you have seen today. That the big stone being held by the basket. That the big stone being held by the basket. Now, if you notice over here, this cannot come out through the channel. So you have to take out the whole stone and the whole system, and again pull in a microscope, go in with a guide wire, with an endoscope again, and start again. This particular case took me about 3.5 hours, and you can see the number of stones removed other than the powder which came out, and this was more than 30 or so my assistant could count, and immediately on the same day the patient was fine without any problem even during food. Another case where this is the only case of foreign body which I have till now, even though people have reported foreign body cases of hair and fish bone, and somebody has reported even an ant in the submandibular duct. This patient had undergone twice intraoral surgery for stone removal, and finally somebody had removed the gland. In spite of that, his symptoms continued, purulent foul smelling discharge from the submandibular. So I decided to put in a scope, because in these cases where submandibular gland is removed, one of the safest cases to start with, because you have nothing to lose. You have to just find a duct opening and put your scope, because there is no gland, so it's not going to cause any other complication. And I was surprised to find a plastic piece behind a stone, and that was the cause for all this. He had undergone total 3 surgeries, 2 intraoral and the gland excision. This was the 4th surgery. If this would have been a direct endoscopy, this would have been out and patient had no other issues. This was another case where gland was already removed 2 years back. Patient has persistent pain in the submandibular region. The radiologist told me that there is suspicion of stone, but again the radiologist would be able to tell you a definite stone if there is a flow of saliva. Since there is no gland, then there is no flow of saliva. He was also doubtful. He said the gland is not there, And then stone, he was not sure whether they are stone. I said, I'll put in a scope. And to my surprise, when I put in, found a lot of stones in the duct. In such cases, when you are doing a silendo, at the end, as you will see at the end of this video, you will hit a blind end, like what we had in the parotid case, in the stenosis. You will see similar to that, and your scope won't pass beyond it. It's basically use of stores, balls and baskets. And at the end now you will see that the duct is just ending blindly. So however high you go while removing a gland, you may still leave the stones inside. So if you see, it was totally blind at the This is a similar case, I would just skip through that. It is similar after gland excision, there was a stone. This is a similar case, I would just skip through that. It is similar after gland excision, there was a stone which had to be removed. Now, coming to advanced procedures, now in silendo there are advanced procedures. In fact, we had kept one today, but lack of time we could not. For the parotid, most of the time it is parotid, combined approach is external, where you require a fascia. Nicely dissect the lingual nerve and go beyond it to take out the stone and repair the duct. What are the indications for combined approach? Stones which are in the secondary duct, intraparenchymal stones which are not very big, and immobile or large impacted stones. Now there is one case of combined approach. Again here the stone reported was quite big, 15 millimeter by 6 millimeter, which is actually a big stone for parotid. So I expected that this would not come out endoscopically, and I was prepared for a combined approach. So as you notice here, there's a facial nerve monitor put at the endoscope inside. This line marking, as you see how I have drawn this, is by putting up the light in the OT and checking the light of the endoscope inside, we have approximately marked the incision. Now there are two ways of going about combined approach. Either you can have a direct incision here, or you can raise a parotid flap and then go on to the duct. Now it is up to patient, and this patient being a little elderly, she preferred that a direct small incision, and I should do it. As you see here, we explored the duct, removed a very large stone from there, and then repaired the duct where I had to put a stent. Obviously, when you repair a duct, it is preferable that you put a stent which goes beyond your repair. So this was almost 8 centimeters. So the stone which was there, which was approximately 7 centimeters from the duct opening, is obviously a right decision to do a combined approach. And that is how a stent looked like there in position. The patient the next day. Coming to lithotripsy. External shortwave lithotripsy. Now, Israel as such is practiced in very few centers in the world. Now, the main problem which has come now, maybe after 5 years, we will not talk about this because we don't have machines for Israel. Karlsruhe was the only company who was making it, but they are top manufacturing. You cannot use a urology machine because it's quite big, and it can cause damage to ossicles, the dental implants, and the lens. So, you have to have a mini lith. The advantages of using mini lith the Israel is, even if there is a large stone, you can break it into pieces and then take it out with endoscope, because you require to do an endoscopy maybe a next day or so, because immediately there will be some inflammation. Depending on how much is the inflammation, they would do either next day or after 48 to 72 hours. One sitting may not be sufficient enough, and after the Israel, the stone size would actually increase because it will break into pieces. Now this is where the ENT surgeon, if he is doing Israel, he needs to know the sonography, because this maximal concentration of the energy which would be required to be done by the operator of the Israel, you have to know the sonography. Without that, you can't do it. So Israel is one thing where you require sonography, you need to know, or you require a radiologist with you to do. And quite an expensive machine for Israel. There are a few contraindications, like any of the lithotripsy, like cardiac pacemaker, post-steppedectomy. If you are a patient with steppedectomy and stone, then you can't use a Israel. And acute inflammation is definitely not a good indication. The favorable results are in stones which are less than 7 millimeter. But I have seen it being used in 15 and 18 millimeter, and still they used to give a good result. But they would require multiple sitting. Holmium laser breaks this quite easily, but as easily it can even damage the duct wall. Now, because it requires a lot of pressure, this is what I was talking about. The red light, which is here, is so bright that you can hardly see the stone when the light is on, even on 1 or 2. I would just talk about one more case of ductal stenosis. I think I showed you one, but this is another one where you can see the stenosis quite well. This patient required continuous massage of the parotid while having food. This is the balloon which we didn't have a chance to use today. This is what he was doing every time he having food. After every 2 minutes, you will have to empty it, otherwise you would get a severe pain. This patient wanted the procedure to be done under local. He didn't want general anesthesia. He was quite cooperative. And we did under local. As you see here, when I pass in the endoscope, initially it's quite a wide, and here you see the ductal stenosis. It's a stenotic segment. Now this is where the saliva was getting hold up. There was no stone. Where I'm dilating is actually little distal to the stenosis, so it's not actually fitting tight, which I realize. Then I inserted the balloon inside. What must be the volume of this balloon? .02 ml to 0.05 ml. If you do anything more than, depending, it's written on the balloon what size it is. If you inflate anything more than that, it will burst. As you can see here, the stenosis is dilated. This patient did not require any second procedure because this was the only stenosis which was there. And then I had put a stent. This type of thick secretions you would get. You can even use basket, but here, as you see, the basket was not sufficient enough to reach to the wall. This is our stent is fixed. I think I showed you today this. Here I used to use proline, but now I have stopped proline, using proline because, you know, causes a lot of ulceration in the surrounding mucosa, wherever it touches. This patient is under local. As I press from outside, lot of saliva coming out there. So there is one more last interesting case. Now two of my cases have appeared in Marshall's book on silent endoscopy. One of those was the 30 stones which I showed you under local, and this was another case where patient had a sublingual gland tumor, and patient was advised to remove sublingual gland and a submandibular gland excision, but patient wanted something more conservative. So what I did is I used a endoscope to negotiate and go till the submandibular gland. With the diagnostic channel in position, under microscope we dissected the whole tumor and preserved the whole duct. Patient didn't require any external incision, it was done all intraorally. This is a consent, I think most of the things are there, but if you need a copy, I can give you that, which covers most of the things for whatever possible during surgery. It is very important to talk to patient beforehand, because as you know, anything can go wrong during silent endoscopy and you may not be able to complete the procedure as you want. Coming to two slides about the training, whoever is interested in silent endoscopy, we have a course at CMAST, and where we have whole 1 day's course. Some of you like Hetal, Dr. Samir, you have attended already, and it's a full day's course where we have at least three faculties every time. This course starts with introductory lectures, the lecture on the basic procedures and the advanced procedures. Then in the afternoon session, you have hands-on. Hands-on is on two, basically on a model which I have developed. In fact, this is our initial model. Now we have changed it quite a lot, where you can actually practice with the scope and the instruments and the baskets, with actual training, how you would hold a stone in the basket or a forceps. After that, there's a training which is there on the pig head, and pig head gives almost realistic experience as you would do in a human being. So this course has been started basically by Dr. Tempton Udwadia, who is the direct chairman there, and with his help I started this course there, and it's doing well. We have already done 3 courses. The course is every 3 monthly once, and we take only 8 delegates. The next course is on 15th March. So any of you are interested, you can just apply to CMAS online and join there. And we have formed a silent endoscopy society where we have more than now 50 members, and Dr. P.P. Singh is the president, I am the vice president, and you, any of you are interested, because we are planning to have our first meeting somehow. So any of you interested in that, you can contact me for that. I think it's time that we take questions from you, because it has been one way or both of us talking, so I need questions to discuss on.
Thanks, Milind, for this elaborate and enlightening lecture. Now what we'll do is, why don't you take a seat on the, yeah, and then we'll take the questions together.
Yeah. The mic.
Okay, let me ask you a first question. The most repeated one till no cost. Till what maximum size can you remove a stone cylindroscopically?
Fragile stone, I would be able to. So if you ask me exact size, so about 5 to 6 millimeter are okay to remove. But if they are fragile, even the bigger one will be.
Okay.
And what will matter is the location. It's not only the size of the stone; it's the location.
Okay. So that was the first half of the question. Second is the not all stones are radio opaque. So what would be the best modality preoperatively?
As I told you, a sonography, pre and post vitamin C. Many a time my radiologist told me there is some obstruction but there is no stone. So those obstruction he could see because he had given vitamin C to chew, and in the flow he could see somewhere it's getting obstructed. And which was reported as obstruction was actually a stone which was not seen on a sonography. So that is one way of knowing. On a similar situation would be on a MR xylography. CT, as you said, not radio distant, say, then it may not show.
Any more questions? Yeah, can you pass the mic there?
What is the recurrence for stones? You have removed stone in a submandibular duct gland, and how frequently they recur?
See, the recurrence as such rate is very, very low unless patient has some other issues. Like I spoke to you about one case with all four glands stones, but she has a parathyroid adenoma, which eventually she got operated. But otherwise, the reason that you would get less often, because like you saw in the last case, I have done a marsupialization of the duct. Now, in that, the small stones will not remain, so it will not grow to a size. And secondly, the once undergone surgery, patient is conscious about the symptoms. So, yes, slightest of the doubt, you would get a sonography done. So, the recurrence rate as such is very, very low.
Can you take the mic, Hitul?
Hello. It is said that basically the stone occurs behind the first stone, because the first stone which has created a lot of stagnation that allows multiple stone to be formed. So once you have done a cylindroscopy and cleared the passage, the stone, then whatever forms comes out, and the stagnation is decreased, so the stone formation also becomes less.
In the pre-silo days, you had patients who had spontaneously, you know, stones coming out. And, I mean, obviously you have seen these patients for, you know, many years and decades. And a small percentage would come back and say, ha, do teen bar hua. But a large number would, you know, it used to be one off stone, but that's it. So it's not that it would keep on happening again and again, unless there is some predisposition to formation of stones.
Sir, actually, just continuation of the question that you asked. Sir, what would be the cutoff that beyond this, I will not go for an cylindroscopy and I'll go only for external, the size of the stone? Would you decide preoperatively or intraoperatively?
Any stone, if it is about 1 centimeter or more and very close to hilum. If it's a big stone, which is in the distal part of the duct, you can still take it up. Can do a combined approach. Rupture in the cell? Yeah, it can happen. In fact, the second case, that was the problem, that just went somewhere through the duct. And the duct is so fragile. In fact, if you get a chance on the cadaver, you should dissect and see how fragile the wall is. And once you puncture and you go out, then you will not be able to find it again.
It would heal up.
Yeah, it will heal up. You can go in this same patient, you can do it after 4 to 6 weeks, it will heal up. Because the salivary flow is there, so there should not be.
Submandibular duct stones, which are larger, impacted. Prior, we used to open approach, but just intraoral. Marsupializing the duct part. Can be a equal good result in comparison with sylendoscopy without gland excision? What we are traditionally doing, not always we are taking gland.
It will give good results only because you removed the stone, your purpose is solved. Even if you don't have a sylendoscope, still the traditional method for the stone which are in the distal part of the duct is good.
Distal part.
And then because you have the endoscope, you will then scan them. Here you will be only
marsupializing.
Another important question. Where do you get the patients from?
From whoever don't do.
Milind sir, in juvenile recurrent parotiditis, how often do you need to do, you spoke about the steroid irrigation. So do you need to do it repeatedly or what sort of protocol do you follow?
See, JRP somehow responds to sylendoscopy very well. In fact, that is the indication where, you know, you should not think second time about not doing it. Even if patient comes with 2 or 3 attacks of JRP, you do a sylendo, do a cortisone, just once wash, because one of the theories for juvenile recurrent parotiditis is a small obstruction at the opening. So the moment you do a sylendo, that gets dilated. And if you're asking me about repeated cortisone, so that can be done if patient has attacks. Otherwise, we don't do it. And all this procedure is obviously done when they do not have an attack. It has to be a attack-free period then we do.
And sir, what is the average consumable cost per case? No, that was... unexpected. No, suppose we are doing a stone for the basket and stuff like that.
See, the guide wire, I think, is cost approximately 5,000 or so.
Indian.
Nothing.
All Indian currency. Yeah.
Indian currency.
Yeah, we are charging in Indian currency. Little less, actually. I just got that. 3.5.
With GST, everything?
With GST,
everything. That's what I said.
3.5 to 4.
Cash me dega to come lega?
The basket is almost 18 to 20. So these two probably, because as Rajiv also said, that sometimes if you reuse the basket,
the possibility of it breaking is higher. So in that case, probably one should be using, if you've opened up one basket, then use it for that particular case. So you should safely assume that around 25,000 would be the consumable cost minimum for a patient.
So in the morning when Bimal was there, he had to leave for an FMSB meeting. So he said, 25,000 ka dalega saman. So, kam se kam 2 lakh to charge karna chahiye. So, I think...
See, I think if you look at that way, then you would never have a patient. Okay. You have scopes now costing how much?
4
lakh each. So, even a scope, if you have 8 lakh scopes, and which can break in your first surgery, your 10th surgery, so that cost also you have to divide.
No, see, my take on this is that not everything needs to be equated only with the costing. Of course, if the basic cost has to get covered, because obviously if there is a patient, you are not going to pay from your pocket to treat that patient. The best you can do is give him a free service. The cost of the consumables will obviously be there. And today, if any of you all have a salivary stone, would you not want to do a silent endoscopy first before you opt for anything else? So it's as simple as that. If I had a stone, I would definitely want to get it at least tried once. If it failed, then it's a second separate thing or it recurred. But at least I would give it that one shot. So why everybody is entitled to that?
As more and more uses happen, I think the cost will come down. There are very few surgeons doing it. So you want, in fact, more people to do. There are a lot of patients, a lot of them.
He's still not charging 2 lakh.
That's individual, no?
Yeah.
I think. So it's like asking, you know, how much would you charge for endoscopic sinus surgery or a tympanoplasty?
Basic costing of the procedure of your operation theater charges, your other consumables for general anesthesia. Today, if you have a 2-hour procedure, then your consumable for general anesthesia using theoflurane comes out to 10,000 rupees. And then the cost of your anesthetist, the cost of your assistant, and then the cost of your own surgery. So any service, you can price it at whatever you want to. Rest of the cost needs to be covered.
Are you any questions?
More procedure, the customer 85-90 is one basket and we use the guide wires. The brush is needed every 2 years.
See, the guide wire, if you use repeatedly, if you notice, those small particles come out.
Over 3-4
What was the youngest patient you operated and for what indication?
Juvenile recurrent, I have done in 3-year-old childhood.
One single sitting?
About JRP, if I operate 10 patients, I would say almost 8 patients do not require second procedure. And they are almost completely clear. Remaining 2, maybe their attacks. I had a patient who had attacks of almost 20 attacks in a year. And it reduced to just 2-3 attacks in a year. Those also were very mild. So that is what I said. JRP is one indication which you must do a silent.
I'm sure these patients, the parents will come asking you, can you do something?
Yeah, because they just keep on changing surgeon and pediatrician. And antibiotic and steroids.
Yeah, and earlier that option was not there or people were not aware of it. I mean, there are so many people who are not aware of
Any other questions? Okay. I think they're all clear. Now I request our AOI Mumbai president to come and express our gratitude and felicitate our faculty.